Good morning, everyone, and welcome to any visitors that we have here today, and welcome to Dr. Kohl. Our call to worship this morning, an invocation prayer, is Philippians 4, 4 through 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. Amen. And our first prayer this morning is hymn number 108. Come, Christians, join to sing. And DeLong is doing a prayers of the people this morning.
Good morning, everyone. Shall I bow our heads in prayer? Heavenly Father God, in the name of Jesus and Holy Spirit, we humbly bow before you this morning in praise and adoration. God, you are so majestic, mighty, powerful, and awesome. Omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent. Creator of heaven and earth and all that is therein. You know everything there is to know about us. And in your abundant love, you shed your precious blood on the cross of Calvary. With arms open wide, you welcomed each of us to come to be redeemed and have a special personal relationship with you. You were not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to a saving knowledge of you and worship a living Savior and loving Lord. In your word, you say that though our sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. 1 John 1 and 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Ephesians 3:20, unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Exceedingly abundantly above all are words packed with infinite love and power to do for those who love him. In Isaiah, we are told that we need to peace, to rest on you. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. In your word that we heard this morning, you give the peace that passeth all understanding, the peace the world does not know or understand, and only those who have experienced it really can comprehend that peace which we read in your holy word. And now, Lord, let's turn our thoughts to others this morning. We remember those who are grieving loss of loved ones. For those who are ill on hospital beds and nursing homes, we pray for the nurses, the doctors, the caregivers, for health and strength to administer to the needs of others. We pray for those who are suffering through the ravages of wars, sometimes without shelter, food, water, heat. For those who have experienced tragedy, such as in tornadoes, earthquakes, fire, floods, and famines. God, we pray that you'll stretch your comforting arms about them to provide them with comfort, peace, hope, joy. We pray that you would bless your anointed servant, Dr. Kohl, as he ministers to us this morning with a spiritual message. May we feel the encouragement and inspiration from it. We would ask that you continue to provide rest, relaxation, and guidance for our own Pastor Sheila as she's on an extended leave of absence from us. We pray for the leaders of our countries, that you will give them wisdom and discernment as they govern our lands. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And now let us pause for a moment while those in our midst may offer their own silent prayers. May we join together in praying the prayer that you taught your disciples so long ago, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen and amen.
Thank you, Fran. Our scripture this morning will be read to us by Deacon Christina Fitch.
Morning. Psalm 100, all lands summoned to praise God, a psalm of thanksgiving. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness for all generations. Amen. Thanks be to God.
Our next hymn is hymn 651, O Master, Let Me Walk With Thee. Call the ushers up, please, and we'll have an offertory prayer. Heavenly Father, please accept this offering that we give to you today and look after us and help us as we go through this week. And take this offering and to look after your house and maintain fellowship that is in here. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. And now the choir will sing Worship the Lord and the Beauty of Holiness.
I think we can clap. Thank you. Thank you for the choir. Thank you for reading the scripture. And thank you for the prayer. I'm very happy to be back here with you. Some already asked how my travel went. It went very well. I had some wonderful experiences. However, there was one thing that was missing. 42 years ago, my wife and I were in the Philippines. I had to speak in a conference, and so we stayed in a guest house one night in order to catch the plane the next morning very early. Well, middle in the night, we heard some noises. So I went up and opened the door, and outside there was a shoebox with a brand new baby, born only a few hours earlier. It was not even cleaned up yet. And there was a note, "Please take care of me. You will never find my parents." So 4 o'clock in the morning, suddenly, we had a baby. in a country where you don't know anybody. I didn't know where the hospital was. I didn't know where nurses are. We were just standing there with that little baby crying his heart out. It was a girl. Fortunately, when we went to the guest house, I saw that at the corner around, there was a kind of a place for Catholic sisters. So I went over and knocked on the door and rang the bell and did everything to wake up these Catholic sisters at 4 o'clock in the morning. Finally, one showed up and I said, "I have a problem, ma'am. My wife and I just got a baby." I had to explain it. "Please come with me. It's in a shoebox and we don't know what to do." Well, she put on an overcoat and went with me and took the baby. She knew there was a nurse nearby and there was a first aid station. They took care of the baby. And because it was a Catholic sister, the priest baptized the baby, usually the first day it was born. And they baptized that little girl in the name of my wife, Barbara. And so whenever I go into the Philippines, I look around for a woman about 42 years old by the name of Barbara. I didn't find her yet. She must be somewhere, probably a mother, if not a grandmother already. So I was looking, and I spread a message everywhere. "Have you seen a beautiful lady by the name of Barbara, about 42 years old?" I had the privilege of speaking in two churches, and I thought I'd share that with you. I'm so happy that you are here in spite of missing an hour's sleep. I know it's tough. Someone even sent me an email and said, "Pastor, be sure you will be in church in time. Don't sleep too long." I was asked to speak in a church and that have never heard about the church, didn't know the pastor. Someone made arrangements for me to go to that church. And apparently the pastor knew about me and he invited me. The pastor told me he has been in that church for 28 years. The church started 28 years ago. In a suburb. It was not in the slums, but it was in a poor area. He started that church. And then he told me that every year, for 28 years, they started a daughter church someplace else. And so that church has 27 daughter churches. And he was training the pastors for these churches. And some of the daughter churches, he said, they are much larger than the church where they started, the mother church where I was preaching. And they had about 350, 380 people that Sunday morning. I was absolutely overwhelmed. They had a real outreach program. So I preached in that church, and in the end, the pastor stood up and said, "Dr. Kohl, would you be willing to speak especially to all our young people between the age of 15 and 25? Between the age of 15 and 25. Over 80 young people came forward. Absolutely amazing. That church really focuses on the younger generation. And there are young people everywhere. It's just a matter of capturing them. They came and I asked them to pray. And that evening, I was not there because I had to speak someplace else. That evening, these young people went out and got all their friends. And the church was packed full with young people. Young people want to hear the word of God. Believe me, there's an inner hunger in each one. As we will see in the sound that we just heard, God made us. Everyone is a creation of God. And there's something in us that longs for God, even if we deny it, even if we don't believe in it. It is in every human being made in the image of God, something that longs for him. Then I had the privilege to be in another church. Shocking, I have to tell you. It was a huge church, huge. And I remember the senior pastor, because 25 years ago, he told me when he started the church, I was with him. I spoke at a seminary, and he was a student, and he said, I want to start a church. And we spoke about it, and he had some great ideas. He said, in our church, every church member, doesn't matter how old that person is, every church member is coming to a training class, biblical training class, for 3 hours, either on Tuesday or Wednesday evening. If not, there are many other churches. Go to other churches. If you come to our church, that is a requirement of every member. And then every month, you have to spend 6 hours in outreach ministry, either to call people or visit people or be involved in visiting people in hospital or in prison or whatever. I told him 25 years ago, my friend, that's a great idea. It will never happen. Well, I followed him over the years. Today, the church has over 10,000 people on Sunday morning. And the church has split already 6 times. There are 6 churches in the Philippines of 10,000 people where everyone is going to be trained, biblical training, every Wednesday or Thursday evening, and spend 6 hours, primarily Saturday morning, going groups outside to help others people. And they all come. Absolutely amazing. Not only that, that church has now outreach in 81 countries in the world. Oh, I wish they would have one in Nova Scotia, Canada. I believe that theory. Everyone wants to be involved, not just to be entertained. Our church is not entertainment. You can get a better one probably on television or someplace else. The church is being involved, sharing, getting other people excited. I had a great time traveling to Asia. All my assignments went well. I think the speaking and the leading of board meetings in cooperation of some organization went very well. That's quite an amazing moment when you share a board meeting as the leader of the group, as the founder and the leader of the group, and you have a couple of bishops and archbishop and all these important people sitting there, and you have to lead them. And I'm just a simple person from Nova Scotia. Thank you for your prayers. It was a real successful trip. Thank you for your support. Well, today we look at Psalm number 100. Psalm 100. I thought this time when I was invited to come to you, I should look at a new series of sermons. I prepare every sermon fresh. I don't have one in the filing cabinet. I don't keep them. And so we spoke about Psalm 23, you remember? We spoke, which is not a psalm for people to die. It's a psalm for the people who live. Beautiful psalm for living. And then we spoke about that psalm that focused on integrity and honesty, Psalm 101. Well, today we look at a very short Psalm 100. Beautiful, beautiful psalm. It talks about joy and gladness, joyful songs, thanksgiving, praise, faithfulness. Some terms that we are all familiar with, but have to become personal. Are we people that are joyful? Are we people that are thankful? To tell you a story. I was pastor of a church for almost 8 years down in the States, one of the oldest churches in the United States, just outside Plymouth, where the Pilgrims landed. They started the second church. What a famous church. Even Daniel Webster, from the Webster Dictionary, and others were members of that church. Great revival took place there. I was there for almost eight years, and was pastor and preached every Sunday. And one Sunday, I preached about being happy, thankfulness, joyfulness. Used the text of Philippians 4:4, rejoice. Again, I say rejoice. The following Wednesday, over dinner time, our youngest son, Jonathan, said, Daddy, I got a glass of water. Thank you. It says in the Bible, if you give someone a glass of water, the Lord will reward you. God bless you. On Wednesday, our youngest son, Jonathan, said, Daddy, today is Wednesday. I haven't seen you smiling yet. And last Sunday, you preached of joyfulness. What's wrong with you? Well, if your son is telling that to you in front of the whole family, you're not only embarrassed, but you really get it. I have to learn, just like you, to be more joyful, to be more happy, to see the things a little bit more colorful and exciting. The psalm says, make a joyful noise. Worship the Lord. It didn't say in the church. It says your entire life, your lifestyle should be joyful. You should be a happy person. The great example is our Apostle Paul. I'm fascinated about that guy. He was in prison. He was beaten. And he began to sing songs of praise. Again, he was in prison. Usually, we people go in hotels when we go to another city. Paul always had a special cell in prison. He was in prison again, and he wrote that beautiful letter to the Philippians. Filled with joy and happiness and thankfulness, he was waiting to find out if he should live or die. And as we know, he had to give his life for his faith. My friends, we have to learn to be more joyful. I discovered that happiness and thankfulness belongs together. You cannot have one without the other. You cannot be thankful without being happy, and you cannot be happy without being thankful. It's impossible. One time, 10 people came to Jesus. You know the story. They all had leprosy. It's amazing that Jesus met with them. Usually, no one could get near to them. And he said to them, go and and do certain things, and that you will be cleansed. Only one, remember, only one came back to say thank you. All the others took it for granted. Are we thankful? I think we should be 10 times more thankful than we are right now. Say more thank you to people. Say more thank you. And you will see that your entire lifestyle is changing. You will become more happy. A friend from Africa wrote me, "The whole world is a series of miracles, but we are so used to them that we call them ordinary things." There are miracles in our lives every day, over and over and over again. We should be more thankful and joyful and happy. I want to be sure that you hear "we." It's not you. "We." I have to learn that too, because I'm not a person who is looking very happy all the time. My mind is sometimes all over the place, and I have all kinds of ideas, and so people have to tell me, "What's wrong with you?" "Oh, nothing. Nothing is wrong." We are so common and so used to things that are great blessings in our lives. When I first came to America to learn English, I was amazed when people came by and said, "How are you?" And so I was thinking, how do I feel? Well, before I could answer, that person was already three blocks down the road. They didn't want to hear the answer. I was a little bit annoyed. So I yelled, "Hey, I am very, very disappointed." We have to learn to be above circumstances. We have to learn that our life depends on His blessings. You remember, all that we have, and all that we have, is not ours. It belongs to God. We are only managers, not owners. Because one day, we have to leave everything behind. We are all terminal cases, by the way, if you liked it or not. I want to tell you the story of the person I thought in my life was the happiest person I ever have seen. He was a pastor. He always smiled. He always was happy. He was just radiant, he and his wife. He was a pastor. And he invited me to his church. I was very eager to find out. He built a church, a big church, 2,000 seats. But they were in the process of building it, and so I was invited to speak in the church, but it had no roof over it. It was just the walls and the benches, and there were 2,000 people. And he said, "Well, we don't have the money yet for the roof. We are waiting to get it, but why not starting the church? If it rains, just bring an umbrella and get warm dressed, and it will work out." So I went to that church, had a chance to preach, and then afterwards I had dinner with him and his wife. My wife was with me, their son and their daughter, teenagers, were with me, and I experienced something that had an impact in my life. We had dinner. And we all six were sitting there, and the wife came in with an appetizer on a plate for each one, or half a banana, an apple, I guess it was, and a knife. And so we had an appetizer. And then the young teenage boy and the girl took the plates and the knife and went out to the kitchen. And we waited for a while, and then the wife came back and brought each one a plate to eat with rice and meat and vegetables and beautiful knife and fork. And so we ate, and then the young people took the plates out again and the fork and knife, and then they came in with a dessert and with a mug of tea, because I don't drink coffee, so they made tea. Later, I went to the kitchen, and I discovered that that family, a pastor of a church with 2,000, had 6 plates, 6 knives, 6 forks, 6 mugs, 6 glasses for water, period. They were so happy. They didn't worry about all the stuff they have. I think that that psalm reminds us, people, let's be more thankful for what we have. When I look at our kitchen, our household, man, we have so much stuff. Believe it or not, when you and I die, there are not too many people who want all that stuff. You have a hard time to get rid of it. Start early, by the way. It says the Lord has made us. The Lord has made you and me. Each one of us are the only model there is. There are no seconds. There are no second person like you. God made each one individual. There's only one little sweetheart girl like the one down here with her doll. It's only one. There are no second. We have some granddaughters. When they were small, they looked like her, but they are not like her. Each one is different. God made you and me, and he asked us to be more joyful and be more thankful, because I made you. You're basically responsible to me. You are mine. I called you by your name. I redeemed you. I want you to live a life of joy and thankfulness until you're with me for all eternity. It is amazing how often we read in the scripture, be thankful, be joyful, because I am your Lord. You remember when we spoke about the shepherd? If he's the shepherd, he takes care of us. He leads us, he directs us. But we have to be the sheep. So many times we want to be the shepherd. We want to run the show. We want to run our lives. And God quite often talks to us, but we are not listening. You remember that beautiful story about Jonah, a man of God. God spoke to him and said, Jonah, Jonah, I have something for you to do. And Jonah was listening, he understood, and he just did the opposite. He wanted to go on a Mediterranean cruise and had found the money, and everything was fine. He even was giving a testimony. What a hypocrite. If God speaks to us, let's do what God says, and all will be a blessing. I rushed through my notes because someone changed the time. I thought he would leave it so that I have an hour extra, but he changed the time. I saw it. My friend, what do we learn? We have to learn to be more thankful. Thankful for the little things. Thankful for a smile. Thank you for just a glass of water, a cup of coffee. Just say more thankful. Not just to your loved ones, which I hope you do it 10 times more than you have done in the past, but also to other people. Say more thank you. And you will see that your life will become much more filled with joy and happiness and thanksgiving. The Lord is good. And we have to learn to be above circumstances. When someone asks me, how are you? I usually say, above circumstances, I feel fine. Because 9 out of 10 say, under the circumstances, I feel terrible. Under the circumstances, the weather and all. We always have a negative excuse. Change it around. Above circumstances, I feel good. Because I'm on the Lord's side. A friend of mine, whenever I call him, he said, how are you? Top of the world, he says. How are you? Well, I'm still climbing, I tell him. I'm not there yet. But let's learn from today to be more thankful. Express your joy more often. And if you can, try like I do. I try very hard to smile more and to have an image that people enjoy looking at. Psalm number 100, what a beautiful psalm. It's a psalm that we could memorize. Sweetheart, that's something you could memorize as you grow up. It's so short. 1 month, you can memorize just one verse. And in the summer, you already know it very well. The Lord is our shepherd. And since he takes care of us, we can rejoice. Yes, we can bring our burden and our difficulties and our worries and our anxiety and all. We can bring that all to him, but leave it there. The problem is we take it back. Come with all your burdens and bring it to me and leave it there. Don't pick it up and carry it around all the time. My time is up. I'm excited that I can share with you Psalm 100, one of the most beautiful psalms. Remember it, memorize it, and live according to. Amen. There's some announcement. Make it short. Time is up.
Morning. Just a note that I found out this morning that Cheryl Linehan is in hospital. So keep her in your prayers. And Eric McDonald passed away last week. He's Duncan's brother. So just keep him in your prayers as well, and the rest of the family. Tish Jackson's birthday's this week. And Lloyd and Don Tancock, their anniversary is this week. Okay, trustees meeting this week on Tuesday evening. Finance meeting what night? Tuesday as well? Okay, so finance and trustees have their meetings this week. This Saturday evening is just friends. Anybody can come. Bring something that you might be able to, there's a list of options that you can bring. Okay, for the Chinese auction. But anybody's welcome. Donna would like to remind the committees all to meet, which two are meeting this week, needs to meet within a month of the AGM according to our constitution, and you have to elect a chair and let Miss Donna know as soon as possible. Anon Baptist Church is having a yard sale and vendor sale on March 25th, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. that the rest of that's in there. And their clothing depot will be open as well on that day. There's a schedule of their clothing depot is on the bulletin board in the entrance for anybody that would like to need that. And Miss Diane would like to speak on behalf of the Christian Ed, right? Yeah, okay.
Good morning, everyone. As chair of the Christian Ed Committee, I just want to make a few announcements. I don't always get them in the bulletin in time. Hello. I don't always get the updates in the bulletin on time, so I thought I'd get up and give you a few updates. I want to thank everybody for helping out and coming to our fellowship luncheons. We had two in the last several months. I want to especially thank the Kids Club for helping out. They're wonderful servers now. I want to thank B, Ellie, Joe, Autumn, Adeline, and Evangeline. They not only serve, but they clean up, they fold the chairs and everything, so they are the future of our functions as far as I'm concerned. And they're more than happy to help out. And we have 9 members on our committee now, and we just added Christine Fitch. And I am thankful and happy that we have 9 members and we have a good group. Again, we're going to host the Easter breakfast on April 7th. Roger and I will work together on a list for next week, and we'll have it posted for any donations that we need. The CE are hoping to have an Easter egg hunt for the Kids Club. We'll have that on their agenda next week. Abby Blanchard is again hired for a summer ministry. She's starting on June 17th for 10 weeks. And this is Abby's 4th term with us, and we're happy to have her again. We're hoping to have a Kohl Canon supper coming up. I don't know when, but I need to talk to several people beforehand. And the Kids Club are willing to help out as well with that one. They're all excited again to work a supper. March 19th, next Sunday, CE are meeting after church. And I also want to ask if anyone is interested in having fellowship coffee. I came in early this morning to put it on and bought cookies. I didn't make any. And it seems like not too many are interested. So will we continue or will we not? Like, I need to know. I have no problem coming in doing it or doing a sign-up sheet. How many are interested? Hands. Seems like you're more interested after. But anyway, we'll see. We'll continue with it, and we'll see how it goes. Thank you very much.
Yes, and our next hymn is 689, The Church of One Foundation.
Thank you.
So the deacon's benediction. I put some thought, quite a bit of thought into each week which one I will choose. And this week usually is based on how I'm feeling the week before. So definitely falling into being a bit more negative and needing to be more thankful, for sure. So this is the one I came up with. So this is not about necessarily about you. It's about, you know, how I've been feeling myself. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. Finally, all of you have unity of spirit, sympathy, love for one another, a tender heart, and a humble mind.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Go in peace.